Welcome to the second lecture on social cognition, and we'll be talking about heuristics. So before I advance the slide, on the next slide I am going to show you some questions, and I want you to pause the video, think about the answer to your questions, and then unpause the video and we'll move on. A heuristic is a mental shortcut, and as you can see here, we have the original road, and then somebody's just taking a shortcut. So heuristics are just these simple things where we, rather than spend a whole lot of time thinking about something, we jump from one point to the other. And we do this because we're cognitive misers. So we don't like spending a lot of extra time on something if we can take a shortcut. The availability heuristic occurs because people judge things as more likely to happen if those things are easier to imagine. So I illustrated this with the sharks versus lightning question, and I imagine that most of you said that more people die from shark attacks than from lightning strikes. But actually, far more people die from lightning than from sharks. So on average, there are 6 fatal shark attacks worldwide, whereas just in the US, there are 32 fatal lightning strikes per year. So you can see that there are nearly 5 times as many fatal lightning strikes just within the US compared to the whole world's fatal shark attacks. So why does this occur? Well, when you first think about lightning strikes, you're probably kind of picturing some lightning, and it's kind of hard to imagine somebody dying from a lightning strike. However, when you picture a shark attack, and I'm just giving you a heads up, there's a sound coming. You are picturing something pretty easily. There are a lot of media representations of shark attacks, and whenever anybody is attacked by a shark, it's all over the news. And so it's really easy for us to picture shark attacks, and so we judge it as more likely to happen, even though in reality, lightning strikes are more fatal. So using whether a case looks like it belongs to a group, rather than using the base rate of whether something is likely to belong to that group, is the base rate fallacy. So I illustrated this with this picture of this guy, and I asked you if he was more likely to be a hairdresser or an engineer. And I imagine that many of you thought he was more likely to be a hairdresser. And why is that? Well, we have a schema of hairdressers, and that schema includes the idea that hairdressers are feminine. And we have a schema of engineers, and that schema includes the idea that engineers are masculine. So this guy is a more feminine looking man than probably what many people picture when they think of a man. And so they think, well, he's kind of feminine, so I think that he's a hairdresser. But the base rate of hairdresser employment is much lower than engineer employment. So you can see that he's actually far more likely to be an engineer than a hairdresser. But the reason why we label him as a hairdresser is because he fits our schema for hairdresser, and we ignore the base rate of those two categories. So now I'm going to ask you, how many architects do you think there are, knowing that there are more than a million engineers? And what you're probably going to do is you're going to think, okay, that's a number of engineers. So I don't think there are quite as many engineers, or there are quite as many architects. Maybe there are 800,000 architects. Or maybe you think, oh, no, I think there's even way less architects. So I'm going to say 400,000 architects. So that is your anchor, that initial number, and you're anchoring on it, and then you're adjusting down. It could also go the other way. You could adjust up. So that's anchoring and adjustment. You have an initial thing, you kind of lock on it, and then you move from that thing. And if you're curious, there are actually only about 100,000 architects in the U.S. So the framing heuristic essentially says, hey, context matters. So if you're presented information about a school, you'll judge it more favorably if it has an 80% success rate rather than if you're presented with information that says it has a 20% failure rate. Even though those two things are saying the same thing, we would say more positive things about a school that has an 80% success rate. And why is that? Well, the word success is a positive word, and we feel good about that word. And so if somebody talks to us about success, we think, hey, that's a good thing. And the word failure is not a very good word. We don't feel good about that word. And so if somebody's talking about a failure rate, we think, oh, that's really bad. So if you frame something in terms of success, people are going to think more positively about it than if you frame it in terms of failure. And that's the framing heuristic.